Ladies and gentlemen, the show is now live. It is 8 p.m. East, although there has been some recent confusion about when this show is scheduled. Rest assured, we are on the air. Now, this program brought to you by Honey Badger Radio. In the Badger Cave, we'll be interviewing noted authors amongst the Honey Badger crew, some of whom you may know from their blogs, numerous interviews, speaking events, and articles. Others you may not be familiar with. On this program, we'll be discussing pivotal or new articles written by the Badgers in order to keep you up to date with their latest work. Tonight's show, Murdergasm, written by our own brilliant Hannah Wallen. We discuss Anita Sarkeesian's Murdergasm. We'll also be delving into the bait-and-switch tactics of feminist theories on toxic masculinity. Put on some waders. We're going deep into the muck of feminist bullshit. They say if you breathe through your mouth, it doesn't smell as bad. They lied. Now, before we continue with the regular show, I ask permission to do so. Shortly after Anita Sarkeesian started tweeting her propaganda, I, the Observing Libertarian, your host, wrote specifically in response to Anita Sarkeesian's comments at the time, which she has since deleted from her Twitter account. Keeping in mind, I wrote this on the day of the event, the school shooting which took place, and I wrote it in response to her tweets as they occurred. So while this is written in first person at the timeline, just keep that in mind. If you go to the main show page for this particular episode, you will see a screenshot of Hannah Wallen's tweet talking about Anita Sarkeesian. And I altered the post in order to reflect that. I will now continue. This is a screenshot of Honey Badger Hannah Wallen tweeting Anita Sarkeesian and Women Against Feminism. It includes a screenshot of Anita's most recent activities. That kid killed himself and another girl and injured four others who are currently fighting for their life in a hospital. Anita didn't even wait for the two bodies to go cold before she used them as props to spread ideological bigotry, to start spewing sexist political diatribe while four kids are in the hospital fighting to survive. It's unconscionable and unforgivable. If she lived any closer to the school, she'd have been on school grounds doing an Instagram with what was left of the kid's skull after he shot himself on the head, with black marker on his face reading, "Toxic Masculinity." Those are sons, daughters, people's children, and you would walk over their bodies and use them as props while they're on the operating table? Anita Sarkeesian, you are opportunistic scum of the worst variety. I am not a religious man. I do not believe in a single all-powerful deity. But I know this, if there is, and this deity is just and righteous, Anita Sarkeesian, you, madam, would burn forever for your utter lack of compassion. I sincerely hope the parents of those children you were so quick to exploit never become aware of your existence. They have suffered quite enough without ever seeing or knowing about your inhumanity. May they be shielded from knowledge of your attempt at profiteering off their tragedy. Good day to you, madam. May the fruits which you harvest be as toxic to you as the propaganda you distribute. Now, having said that, we will continue with the normal show. We have with us Hannah Wallen, always Hello. Charming and brilliant. Hannah, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself. Tell us about what you've been up to and what you do on the sideline, aside from just being a honey badger.
Just muted again. I just got back from the KSU Men Conference in Georgia. That was quite an exciting event. And I think A Voice for Men will have stories and videos up from that shortly if they don't already. But I write mostly. I write on breakingtheglasses.com's my blog, and then I write for the Honey Badgers on the Honey Badger blog, and I also write for A Voice for Men, and occasionally for Gender Attic and mensrights.ca. I guess that's pretty much it, mostly writing.
Okay. Crystal, you want to go ahead and introduce yourself, what you're up to, and what you do on the sidelines, aside from just being a honey badger, as if that were just being a honey badger, really?
I have we have the petition for the UN Men to be created in the United Nations, which can be found on my Twitter, which is Crystal Garcia, that's K-R-I-S-T-A-L. Garcia, and it's pinned to the top of my wall, so for those listening, if you can sign and share to bring the votes to... we're almost at 2,500 votes. Signatures. Sorry, I'm tired. And once we reach... people have been asking how many signatures. I noticed that the White House listened to 220,000 signatures, but as many signatures as we can possibly get would be amazing, and once we reach 5,000 signatures, I'm going to go to the UN with a bullhorn. So I'm doing that and working on the book Loving and Celebrating Men.
Crystal, don't you also have another blog, 100 Days of Celebrating Men? Something
oh,
like
yes,
that?
Yes. I'm also writing 100 Days on How to Treat Men Right, which I am actually a little bit behind from last Friday, so that'll be up tonight. And that's normally up every Friday. And I write Ask the Badger, well, you guys know that, which is now bi-weekly. So that's what I'm up to. Yes, bi-weekly.
I do try and keep up on what people are, you know, doing. So that's why I decided, it's like, wait a minute, is there something else in there? Hold on a second.
Right. Yeah, so dead.
Right. So, Chris, pardon me, Hannah, your article here, Murdergasm, which, by the way, fantastic name for an article. That draws attention right away.
That's pretty much what she did, too.
She must have been, when she was tweeting that, she must have been just about ready to slip off her computer chair.
Well, see, that's what I pictured pretty much. Because I came home from an errand, and there was all this news out. When I first heard about the shooting, I didn't even hear where it happened. I didn't know for sure even that it wasn't local to my area. And I get home, and I'm looking up information about it and everything. And there on, this is after I found out it wasn't local to my area, but there on Twitter is Anita Sarkeesian tweeting about toxic masculinity and saying it's always men and boys committing mass shootings and saying that it's, 98% of them are male and linking to articles that actually don't prove what she's saying, that 98% of school shooters are male. So, the first thing I thought about that with that is, what if the families were hit in the face with something like that right after, the events took place, and here's this idiot calling their children toxic and blaming gender for the reason why this happened, when clearly there were other issues going on. They didn't even have all the other information out yet.
Yeah, she just made assumptions and rolled with it. As you said so aptly, Murdergasm, she could not wait. Actually, in your article, she specifically stated, where is it? And I quote, "She couldn't even wait for a body count before jumping in to exploit."
Yeah, yeah. She didn't even wait to find out all of what happened. Sorry. And it was like she just heard about this, oh boy, a mass shooting, and she got all excited and ran out there and started tweeting. And then, sure enough, what comes up next? Her Patreon. It wasn't her Patreon, it was her website. Go to my website, donate to me. And the next thing you know, she's bitching about not being able to do that because somebody DDoS'd her.
I hope a lot of people DDoS'd her. I hope nearly the entire internet DDoS'd her. I was looking through some of the responses on Twitter, and wow, did she show her ass.
Yeah, she really did. This was a situation, too, where I don't think she realizes what she did. And the reason she doesn't realize what she did is the reason why she did what she did. She doesn't see men as human beings. Because if she did, she would understand why it bothers men to hear over and over and over again dysfunctional characteristics that are genderless, attributed to masculinity, and called toxic. And further used to associate toxicity with masculinity. I mean, this is something like people have slowly over time started to figure out, you know, you can't say nasty things about a child in front of the child because children are people too and they understand what you say and it hurts them. People know that you can't be racist and people know that, you know, you can't be sexist towards women. The last step in the world seems to be to figure out that you can't say nasty things about men in front of men without men having an emotional response to that as well, having it affect men's self-image and men's self-esteem. And the idea that a characteristic that we know is not limited to men and boys, that we know is genderless, the idea that that will be attributed strictly to men and that that will be used to associate masculinity with toxicity is a teardown. And for her to honestly believe that she should just be free from criticism for saying that and that there should be no angry responses to that, it is the same thing as her feeling like she should be able to walk up without provocation and slap somebody across the face and have them not respond.
Which all too often we see women do.
Yeah. And it's just, you cannot, the only thing that I can think is that she does not view men as human in the way that she views women as human and vulnerable. She doesn't see that in men. She does not understand that humanity includes men.
Indeed. I was watching in one of my most recent articles, I just finished writing it last night, I think. At the very end of that, I mentioned the book Self-Made Man by Nora Vincent. A wonderful book. She did an interview for 2020. At the end of the interview, she actually said, the narrator put in that her views of men after this experiment. And what she did was she cross-dressed as a man and passed as a man for 18 months, doing normal guy activities, getting a job as a man, going to a strip club as a man. And she wanted to look into all these male areas and literally be as male as possible by immersing herself in maleness, basically. And she lived this for 18 months. Now, interestingly enough, and this is further proof that gender is not a social construct. Because she passed as a man for 18 months, in the interview she talked about how that negatively affected her in terms of identity, who she was, and what she was. And at the end of the experiment, she literally checked herself into a mental institution for depression. Proving, once again, gender is not a social construct. It's innate qualities of a person's nature. And that nature is centrific to each individual person. But during the interview, the narrator mentioned about how her views as of men had changed dramatically. And she starts going in and she explains, you know, men are suffering. They don't have our problems, meaning women. They have different problems, but men are suffering. They need our love, and they need our sympathy, and they need men more than anything else. They need to be around men. And then the interviewer asks her, do you think women understand what it's like to be a man? And she was just absolutely indignant to the question itself. She said, no idea. Not a clue. None. And you can, I'll post the article. It hasn't been published yet. It will be. But anyway, Let's get back on topic on your article. You mentioned about when Nita Sarkeesian started linking these articles that were supposedly to prove that these issues like violence was gendered. And you mentioned the study done by John R. Lott Jr., evaluated by FBI-cited studies, and about how these were not accurate and they excluded a lot of female violence. They included a lot of things that were not actually school shootings at all. Would you like to go into detail about that?
There's a couple things I noted here. The first thing is Anita specified mass shootings in her first tweet, but then in the other tweet, the one that she listed the Feminist Current article to, that one she specified school shooters. Now, the article that she linked to had as its support, that article had as its support articles that discussed mass shootings that were not all school shootings, and it did not include all mass shootings. And the other thing about this is, as we go back and we start discussing the FBI-cited study that John Lott Jr., or John R. Lott Jr. evaluated, one of the things that he went through and found was that they had included shootings in which one or fewer people died as mass shootings. And let's see if I can open this up here. There were two statistics that have been bandied about recently in relation to mass and school shootings. Michael Bloomberg's Everytown for Gun Safety said that there were 74 school shootings since Sandy Hook, and the truth was there were only 10 as far as the Sandy Hook type. And the other 64 actually involved things that would not be considered school shootings by the standards of your average reader. things like a gun discharging accidentally, a dispute between two students, gunplay that happens on school property after school hours when students are not in the building, robberies or other crimes where there was a pursuit, where the pursuit went onto school property but did not involve students. So there were a plethora of things that they all lumped in together to get those big numbers. And then out of all of that, they excluded a number of female shootings, and I didn't even really do a lot of research to find the female shootings. I just looked up a few. There are actually quite a number more than I found, and I've been finding them a little bit at a time since then. The ones that I have in the article, the first bunch of them I found just by finding an article by Psychology Today's Peter Langman, who wrote about the fact that, you know, there's this thing bandied about also that most school shooters are white. This is also not true. There are minority school shooters. There are female school shooters, so they're not all white males. And he had a list of female perpetrators, and I looked up their stories, and, you know, their stories actually go back to the 80s. And as I was looking those up, mentioned among them was another one. And then later on in a Twitter discussion where I was asked about worldwide school shootings, I ended up doing a little research for that discussion and just accidentally found another one. And I'm certain that if, you know, I did an actual, spent some time on the search instead of maybe just 15 or 20 minutes looking them up, I would find several more. So it's pretty clear to me that this isn't a behavior that is unique to boys or even largely limited to boys. It's just not as widely discussed when girls do it. It doesn't make, you know, news quite as widely when girls do it, although at least one female shooter has been immortalized in song. Let's see if I can find that here. Well, maybe I can find it. Maybe I can't.
Well, why don't I give you a few minutes to look for that while I...
Oh, I found it.
Oh, all right, go ahead.
Sorry.
This is perfectly fine.
Yeah. All right, and this was an Irish band, Boomtown Rats, wrote the lead singer of the song, or lead singer of the band wrote a song, I Don't Like Mondays, based on the famous quote from Brenda Spencer.
Right.
Who, in 2009, apparently, or no, not in 2009, her crime took place, actually, in the 80s, but was recently denied parole in 2009. And he wrote that whole song based on her crime. So when guys commit mass shootings, it's this big, horrible, toxic thing, and it's, you know, associated with their gender. But when girls do it, pop stars write music based on their behavior.
Tremendous double standard. I'm going to go ahead and open up the floor to Crystal. She's been waiting very patiently in the rafters. Crystal, was there anything to add or anything that you wanted to point out? Remember, your mic is muted right now. You have to unmute. Ooh, we may have lost Crystal, ladies and gentlemen. Crystal, are you there? Please unmute.
So, my screensaver came on, and then it wouldn't let me get on the screen. Anyway, what did you say? I missed it because I was struggling with the computer.
Oh, I was asking whether or not you had anything to add or anything that you wanted to point out in the current discussion.
It's just sick. It's twisted, and I definitely agree with the fact that this creature does not see men as human beings. And it's really disturbing, and it's something that needs to be addressed with these people, but it's not. It's just being called feminism. Oh, I don't see men as human beings. I'm a feminist. Okay, well, that's not normal. You know, that's just, it's not, and I know there are feminists who are not like that, but, you know, the majority have this huge blind spot regarding men as being a part of humanity. And that's a problem. That's not normal. You know, that's not healthy nor normal. And that tweet was just out of control, and she just thinks it's okay to say these things because we've lived in a society where this stuff has become normalized. Like, oh yes, this is completely normal. This bigotry is absolutely just acceptable. It's just very twisted. I can't really. It's can't. I just can't.
Once again, I don't want to interject too much of my own material on this because we are talking about Hannah's article. Hannah, earlier before the show, I mentioned the fact that I had reworded a part of Shakespeare, A Merchant in Venice, Act 3, Scene 1, Shylock. It's very famous. I reworded the dynamic. It's a completely accurate representation. Instead of it being a Jew versus Christian dynamic, it's instead a man versus woman dynamic. Would you mind if I went ahead and read that? Because this seems like the appropriate time.
I would love to hear it.
Okay. Let me see if I can find it real quick. Here it is. As I said, it's a parody replacing the Jew-Christian with man-woman. Modified by me, obviously. To bait fish with all, if it will feed nothing else, it will feed my revenge. She hath disgraced me and hindered me 500,000, laughed at my losses, mocked at my gains, scorned at my nation, thwarted my bargains, cooled my friends, heated mine enemies. And what's her reason? I am a man. Hath a man not eyes? Hath a man not hands, organs, dimensions, senses, affections, passions? Fed with the same food, hurt with the same weapons, subject to the same diseases, healed by the same means, warmed and cooled by the same winters and summers, as a woman is? If you prick us, do we not bleed? If you tickle us, do we not laugh? If you poison us, do we not die? And if you wrong us, shall we not revenge? If we are like you in the rest, we will resemble you in that. If a man wrong a woman, what is his humility? Revenge. If a woman wrong a man, What should her sufferance be by women's example? Why, MGTOW. The villainy you teach me I will execute, and it shall go hard, but I will better the instruction.
That is awesome. And I love that you put that with MGTOW. That is perfect. And it's pretty much what, you know, it is pretty much what I've always thought ever since I learned of the phenomenon of men going their own way. And I thought, you know, it just serves women in general, not like all women everywhere, but women as a group, right? That if we as a group cannot stand up for the application, the equal application of human rights to both genders, and understand that both genders includes men and boys, that we don't deserve a relationship with men. You know, if you can't treat a person like a human being, and you can't be invested in that person's welfare, you don't deserve a relationship with that person. Just as you wouldn't acknowledge a person's deserving of a relationship with yourself if they didn't offer you those things.
Indeed, I've said that forever. Now I know Crystal is just chomping at the bit to get in on this discussion. Go right ahead. Remember, you're muted. You have to click the thing at the top of the screen. I think she's been... I think she's been subjected to the evil screensaver once again. Crystal!
It's the E-machine virus.
E-machines. Oh my god. I had one of those. Not only did I have an E-machine, I had an E-machine that came with Windows ME.
Oh my god.
I know. I once had, I shit you not, a 38-hour defrag.
Finally! Oh my god. Yeah, I'm going to turn that fucking thing off. It's pissing me off. I don't know how the fuck to do it, but I'm going to shut it off.
Don't you just wiggle your mouse every few seconds, and then it will never turn on.
No, I'll just shut it off. Because I won't remember. I'll be listening, and then I'll be like, oh shit. So okay, I got to figure that out somehow. But anyway, damn it, it takes me away. Right, and I, like I said, yes, we are definitely talking about Hannah's article. Just to bring up real quick, Marshall's article on deprogramming women's hatred of men, which I think is such a vital article as well. I don't know, it's just so frustrating to watch this stuff and people just eat it up. You know, I mean, she was on, what was it, the Colbert Report recently, and she was the one leading the trying to shut down the Colbert Report, which, so honestly, it makes me think that possibly Colbert was just trying to cover his ass by bringing her on and you know, getting feminist favor all over again. I don't know. See how long that works for. But, you know, I watch her, and I'm just like, God, you know, how is her life difficult? How has her life been difficult? What was so hard in her life? You know, I see her there on the Colbert show and just lounging, talking all this misandric crap, and trying to make sense out of how she's making a living off of this. I don't understand. Like, she is literally making a living off of her own hatred. That's her income, is her hatred.
I tend to think of Anita Sarkeesian as any other social baiter, meaning someone who baits the social issue and then feeds off of the discourse that follows, and then, oh, by the way, I'm fighting against this, so give me money. The same way that she was when the Murdergasm occurred, as soon as she managed to strip those soaked-ass panties right off her butt, she was like, oh, by the way, give me money, give me money.
Yeah, and then when she experienced a little bit of, you know, a little bit of backlash on that, where people were calling her names, which, you know, I'm sorry, I don't see any difference between saying, I think it's worse what she said. what she said is that murder, that killing those around them because of their attempt to fit into society in the role that society has told them they have to fill, that's intrinsic to men. That is what she basically has said, that men can't fit into society in the role that they've been given to fit into society without killing people because they're men. And then some people called her a cunt. I'm sorry, but you know, if I were faced with people saying one of two things about me, you guys could call me a cunt all day long. That's fine. Right. You can call me any name you want. Just, you know, don't attribute a deadly temper to me that I can't control because I'm trying to be the best woman I can be. Because that's just bullshit.
Right. Right. I mean, come on. This is what she's bitching about. She gets called a cunt. I get called a cunt all the time. I just celebrate it. I'm like, yeah, woo, here I am. I am the cunt. Thank you. You know, come on. Get off it. It's just, it's such bullshit. She's turned this into being called a cunt. Her life is at risk or whatever the fuck she's fabricated, you know, and it's ridiculous.
She talks a lot about tropes, yet every time that she specifically instigates, and I'll say that again, she specifically instigates hatred being thrown at her because she is saying and doing such hateful and egregious things to people. Every time she instigates this, she damsels, oh me, oh my, look what they're saying about me. She is her own trope.
She's like that.
She's the Sarkeesian. That's a trope. Not only is that a trope, she should just be her own logical fallacy. It should be ad Sarkeesian.
She's like that little girl at the park that goes up and hits a guy, and then when he hits her back, she's like, Mommy, that guy hit me!
Yep. That's exactly it.
Speaking to the concept of this bait-and-switch tactic that feminists are constantly using, attributing things that are not gendered to men, toxic masculinity, hegemonic masculinity. These things are feminist constructs. And I say constructs because they're not real. They're fake. I actually took the liberty of digging up some statistics. And these are some things that feminists blame men for. And I'm going to bring them up one at a time. And then we'll sit and discuss. Actually, we don't really have time for that. So I'll bring them up briefly, and then you bunch can add your input on that. Does that sound good to you?
Okay. Sounds good to me. Sure.
Okie dokie. Here we go. One thing, domestic violence. They constantly talk about men's violence, and they often talk about domestic violence. And I'm sorry, but what they say about domestic violence isn't really about domestic violence. And they're not telling the whole story by any sense of the word. They really aren't. When it comes to domestic violence, there's an article published by Murray A. Straus at the University of New Hampshire. It was published in the Journal of Aggression, Maltreatment, and Trauma. The article is Current Controversies and Prevalence Concerning Female Offenders of Intimate Partner Violence. What he discussed was, simply put, a small synopsis of that is Straus cites over 200 studies conducted by the United States government, which determined no statistical significant difference in the frequency of violence against a cohabiting partner or the minor or severity of the injuries dealt to the victim between men and women. There is no statistical difference between it. And when the CDC decided to look into it, the CDC, despite being heavily manipulated by feminists like Mary P. Koss, the CDC researchers, Whitaker, Halle Seuss, Swan, and Saltzman, all PhDs, they found that 50% of domestic violence is mutual. It's a man and a woman hitting the shit out of each other. 50% of it is non-reciprocal. And that's the difference. They reference reciprocal violence, which is where both parties are hitting each other, being violent towards each other, and non-reciprocal, which is where one partner is not being violent, but the other partner is. And what they discovered is 35% of all cases of non-reciprocal domestic violence, where one partner is only being violent and the other partner isn't, 35% of those cases, it's a violent woman and a non-violent man. Even though we have this social stigma of a man beating a woman because, you know, dinner was cold when he got home. No. 50% of all domestic violence is reciprocal, meaning they hit each other. 50% is non-reciprocal. 35% of that, meaning 35% of all domestic violence, involves a non-violent man being acted upon by a violent woman.
Wait, I actually saw from Harvard's thing that it was 70% that was women.
They're examining the difference between there's a chasm here. There's a play on numbers that you have to pay attention to. I will explain that now. 70% of non-reciprocal violence is perpetrated by women. But that's when you take... See, the fact is it's 50% reciprocal, 50% non-reciprocal, 35% non-violent man, 15% non-violent woman. But if you only look at the non-reciprocal violence, then 70% of non-reciprocal violence is a female perpetrator.
Right.
Yeah. They're looking at half of a whole statistic, and then examining how much of that percentage is man versus how much of that percentage is woman.
Which means 30% of all violence is female only against male.
No, 70% of all.
Yeah, I know. So that 70% of the... because they were looking at a part of a percent.
Exactly.
So you were saying 30% and 15, right? 35 and 15 is the between the two. Now, 35 and 15 does not add up to 100.
No, it doesn't. It would be 70 and 30.
Yeah.
Of non-reciprocal violence,
right?
70% is a woman attacking a man who is typically non-violent.
Right. So 30%. That 35 number then is 35% of all. That 35 versus 15?
Exactly.
35% of all domestic violence is woman on man, one-sided. And only 15% of all domestic violence is man on woman, one-sided. That is the thing they portray as the majority of domestic violence, man on woman, one-sided, is that little 15% in comparison to all of the rest. 50% is two-way.
Exactly.
So what you're seeing there, it's not just a bait and switch.
It's a lie.
It's a complete cover-up.
Yeah, it's a complete fabrication. It's a fraud.
Yeah. And that's something that they do on a regular basis. They do it with, and they do it with other things too. Like,
indeed.
This is actually how feminists hide information, and they'll single out. Just the slice of information they want you to look at. Just the thing that they can frame to suit their agenda. And they'll exclude everything else. They did the same thing with workplace deaths. They made a claim that homicide was the leading cause of workplace deaths in women. Now, to make that claim, they looked at causes that were not accidental or were not accidents as a separate, you know, set of things, and then they looked at accidents as one unit. No, I had that backward. They looked at accidents as a whole separate set of things, and then homicide. But then if you look at the homicide thing, you break the homicide down, there are different types of homicide there too. There's the partner homicide, there's burglary, there's other, you know, coworker homicide, all types of different things, and they made this claim, and it was a false claim. This was just a flat-out lie, that the majority of homicides against women in the workplace were committed by an intimate partner. It was not true. The majority of homicides against women in the workplace were, I believe, in the course of a burglary. I don't have the statistic in front of me, But that part was a lie, so they combined a lie with a little bit of chicanery. The majority of workplace deaths in women occur due to accidents. But if you split accidents up into the various types of accidents and take the percentage, a separate percentage for each one, then homicide very slightly tops the list at, I think, 28%. So it's still even, you know, not even half of workplace deaths.
Not even a quarter.
Still not a majority of workplace deaths. It is just a larger piece of the pie.
Right.
That has been cut into smaller slices by dividing a category into subcategories.
Yeah, they're looking at a canvas painting of an ancient battlefield and then giving you a microscope to look at one little scene in the foreground of what could be something violent happening to a woman and saying, look, this is what it was. And meanwhile, you take
the entire battle.
Exactly. You take away the microscope and you look at the entire picture and it's like, well, how about all these hundreds of thousands of other people that are dying, killing each other in order to save that one woman? What's up with this?
But don't you know, women have always been the primary victims of war.
Oh, God. Every time I have a meme that... I have a meme
that says...
I think that's
the silliest thing Hillary's ever said.
Oh, God. I literally, every time the topic of Hillary comes up for 2016, right, I've got a meme, and it's her, a nice picture of her at like a podium, you know, Hillary 2016, like her campaign photo, right? And underneath that, directly underneath that, it's got a picture of Stewie with a gun in his mouth from Family Guy.
Jeez. Well.
It's funny. It at least calms stress. But they do the same thing with rape. The egregious way in which this... I'm sorry?
No, go ahead.
Actually, I should... Well, we're running out of time here. An hour just doesn't seem long enough to cover all these issues. They did the same thing with rape. When the CDC, heavily lobbied by Mary P. Koss, responsible for a host of egregious activities, when they published their numbers, their most recent numbers on rape, they had neglected to mention to the general public that men were no longer able to be raped by a woman unless she shoved something in his mouth or up his ass. And the majority of rape on men by women does not occur that way. They created a special category. I talked about it at length in my article, Rape Culture. They created a special category called Made to Penetrate. Now, if you ask the normal everyday person on the street, if someone forces you to have sex against your will, either by physical force, putting a gun to your head or a knife to your head, or coercion of threats, you know, if you don't do this, then they'll do something against you, or they'll get you in trouble in some way, or they'll report you, blah, 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 blah. The various ways that someone can be coerced, or they get you nice and drunk to where you can't physically respond, or they get you drugged using such as the date rape drug, GHB, or you're unconscious, and they literally just rape you while you're unconscious, have sex with you against your will, you're unable to consent. Now, you ask this of a normal everyday person, and you say, is that rape? And resoundingly, 100% of the time, pretty much, they say, yes, that is rape. According to the CDC, that is not rape. If a man is subject to that by a woman, it is not rape. It is referred to as made to penetrate, which, by the way, it's not just classified as a sexual assault. It's classified as a lesser sexual assault than rape. Even though every normal, reasonable, rational, logical person would define it as rape, the CDC decides otherwise. It's not rape. It's made to penetrate. It's a lesser sexual assault crime, which carries a lesser sentence. Thank you very much.
Amazing.
Isn't it?
Un-be-fucking-able.
Yeah, I actually, in my article, if I can bring it up quickly, I mentioned a specific case that was very recent to when I wrote the article itself. A woman literally invited a man who was walking into her cab, into her vehicle to give him a ride to where he was going, and he said, yes, I'm getting to it now. But shortly after he got into the vehicle, she pulled a gun on him and forced him into the back seat to have sex with her friend. So he's pleading. The woman who led him into the vehicle was Sierra Ross. Ross, age 25, stopped and asked 33-year-old man if he wanted a ride. He took the offer. She forced the man into the backseat, told him to have sex with her friend. The man pleaded for the woman to stop after they made him fondle the woman's breast and butt. Ross then ordered the man to take off all his clothes, and her friend began to sexually assault him. The woman took $200 and his credit cards, and when he spotted a taxi, he literally ran from the vehicle, buck-ass naked through the street, jumped in the taxi, and then asked the taxi driver to use the driver's cell phone and took a picture of the license plate of the car that Ross was riding in. She was later apprehended. Now, according to the FBI, and anyone with two brain cells to rub together, this is rape. She forced him at gunpoint to have sex with someone against his will. This is rape. Unequivocally. Unabashedly. This is rape. But according to the CDC, that's not rape. That's made to penetrate.
That's awful.
But here's the thing. If you look at the CDC's official numbers, which Hannah herself has written about in detail several times and talked about at length, if you look at the data from the CDC and you actually include sexual assault of men, you find out that men and women are raped at almost the same exact rate. The numbers are, for the 2010 data, I believe it is, 1.27 million women, 1.267 million men, victims of sexual assault.
That is why they do not want to define it as rape when it happens to a man, because they don't want to admit that it happens just as much to men.
Exactly.
And I have a, you know, I have a belief, and I have not been able to fully investigate that belief because the numbers have been pretty much withheld from me in violation of the Freedom of Information Act. But I have a belief that the percentage of female perpetrators men faced during the 2010 time period isn't going to be all that different from the lifetime numbers, which was 40%. 40%, if I got that right. No, it wasn't 40%. It was a majority number. It was like 60-something percent of the perpetrators who forced men to penetrate were women. Allison, what did you say?
I said it was 80%.
Was it 80%? Okay.
Yeah, and there's no reason for them to not give you those numbers unless they were higher.
Ladies and gentlemen, I should let you know that we are now joined by the infamous Typhon Blue, otherwise known as Allison Tiananmen.
Hi. I just wanted to point out that the numbers are, the only reason why they would hide those numbers is if they're higher than 80%.
Yeah.
Because if they were low, they would reveal
them.
They
would have given them to me. Yeah.
Yeah, they would have given them to you. So we know now that the lower bound is 80%, and it's likely that the number of men who are raped by women in the last 12 months is higher than 80%. So it's more likely to be similar to the numbers that you find in other statistical instruments that look at the rape of men by women, which is to say 95% to 98% of the rapists of men in the last 12 months. You usually have to specify the last 12 months because for whatever reason, guys tend to not. I've said in the past that they may be actually forgetting or misremembering or reducing the violence of their female aggressors over time. And to recognize yourself as a rape victim, you sort of have to recognize the violence of the aggressive act. But so another thing also occurred to me, and that is because men don't get any help for being raped, in particular they don't get any help when their aggressor is a woman, it may be that if you look at longer time periods than 12 months, what's happening is that men are dropping out because they are killing themselves, or they're becoming homeless, or they're becoming institutionalized, and then they're no longer captured by the statistical instrument.
There's another aspect of this. Women, when women are injured and we emote about it or talk about it, we are coddled to an extent. Actually, to a very distinct extent. We're told to go to therapy. We're told to get help. We're offered assistance. We're offered all kinds of support. When men are injured and they emote about it, unless that injury affects their utility to others, they are told to suck it up and drive on. And in particular, if failure to suck it up and drive on interferes with their utility to others, they are shamed for failing to suck it up and drive on. So when something like this happens to a man and he survives it, or when something like this happens to a boy and he survives it, over time, it is in what he is taught by other people, what his place is in society. He's taught that he's not important enough as an individual, and his individual experiences are not important enough for him to keep track of that. He should suck it up and drive on. So you're not going to hear about stuff that happened to men 20 years ago or 10 years ago or 5 years ago because time has passed, they survived, they've moved on. And it's only like the younger generations that are going to start talking about these things because we now have more of a tendency, although we're still not doing a very good job of it, we have more of a tendency to try to support men in talking about this one particular subject than we did before. And when I say more, it's like maybe we've added a few grains of salt worth of encouragement where we need to add, 10 pounds. But it's a start. So I expect us to, I expect that pattern to change in the future.
Go ahead, Crystal.
Right. I saw a sign. I was looking up pictures of the mines, the different mines across the globe, and there was, I don't know how old the sign was, but it didn't look that old. I don't know if it was a decade or so. Anyway, there was a sign in the mines that said something to the effect of, make sure you stay safe because if something happens to your family, what will they ever do? Like, it had nothing to do with, oh, we hope you have a safe, experience because we don't want you to be hurt. No, it was completely dismissive that they could be hurt. Didn't matter. It mattered that what would their family do if they got hurt. So it was complete dismissal.
Yeah, don't get killed. Your family needs the money.
Right. What the hell?
Yeah.
Good God.
Male disposability, it's always a topic because it's always true.
Yeah. And it's at the bottom of a lot, pretty much every men's issue, really. If men were not treated as disposable, then it would not be so easy to tolerate all of the injustices against them.
Indeed. Allison, was there anything that you wanted to add to that?
No, I don't know where the conversation has been, so I don't know how much I can add. I wanted to just talk about the statistic. And have you guys talked about this new proxy victimhood co-option by, I think it's Brianna Wu? Was it?
Oh yeah, the tweet.
I saw that earlier. Brianna
Wu tweet. Yeah. Yeah, she's... dang it. She tweeted about a murder that was very loosely linked to 4chan. This was not like, we suspect 4chan did this and they're a prime suspect or anything like that. No, there's just a loose association. And actually co-opted the victimhood by saying, and you guys don't think I'm in any danger? Hello? Like, look what happened to this person. I'm in danger. And that was her first thought as soon as she saw that. How can I make myself a victim of someone else's tragedy? It's the same thing Anita Sarkeesian did.
Ed Sarkeesian. I keep saying it should be its own logical fallacy.
No. How can I make myself the victim of someone else's tragedy?
It's unbelievable. My God. Someone else died. I almost almost was in the same area. Holy crap, I'm so oppressed. Oh my god, yeah. I can't. You know, these people.
I read about somebody's death. Poor me.
Exactly. Unbefuckingable.
She's in no danger from 4chan. There's a reason that people left 4chan and have gone to 8chan, and that's why we now refer to it as Half-chan. Because 4chan was corrupted by one of the biggest devs in it, literally dating a feminist.
So now 4chan can only 1.5 Vectra.
Yes, indeed.
Alrighty then.
let me go back to the talking points here and see what else we can bring up. I think we've talked about almost everything. We may actually get it done. Actually, there is one issue left, and we may actually go past an hour. Are you three good to stay, or do you have some pressing issue that you need to get to?
I can stay. I just need to pop off for a bit, and then I'll be right back.
Okay.
I gotta get going. I would say end at a strong note. Leave them wanting more.
Okay.
Rather than less.
So you're saying go ahead and keep going and then, or just leave it as it is?
Nope, she's already gone.
Oh, doesn't she just always do that? She pops in for 5 minutes, ladies and gentlemen, and then she's gone again. She's the ninja of the honey badgers. That's what she is.
Gandalf.
speaking Badger of Dolph. Grape, nice segue there, I know. Speaking of grape, and a nice cheerful voice. Dogs barking in the background. In the article Rape Culture, I don't want to go too much into it, but I literally talked about Mary P. Koss. When she was doing her statistic, her false statistic, to try and claim that men rape women at an astronomical rate, according to the National Statistics on Crime, actually per year, 2 out of every 1,000 women will be raped in the United States. Not 1 in 4. It's 2 out of 1,000. But anyway, during her fake statistic, she literally determined, by her own research, and did not publicize it, by the way, that 95% of men, the overwhelming vast majority, 95% of men, it's actually slightly over 95% of men, it's 95 point something something, 95% of men will never commit rape. Ever. Not even the, you know, issue of murky consent type of rape. They will never do it, because rape is such an abhorrent topic to men. It is an abhorrent crime to men. They despise it. They are disgusted by it. 95% of men will never rape at any point in time. Of that last little less than 5%, 1.34, I think it was, percent are murky consent, where they weren't sure. They went ahead, and then they found out, no, that was actually rape. She wasn't able to consent at the time. Or, you know, she didn't really provide consent. Even though she didn't say no, there were indicators that he could have picked up on. And of those men, they can be rehabilitated. They can be rehabilitated, go back into society, lead perfectly normal lives. It was a mistake. It happens. The Don't Be That Guy campaign is only ever effective to that 1.34%. That's all it really addresses. 95% of men will never rape. Not every man is a potential rapist. The vast, overwhelming majority of men will never rape. They will never commit rape. Now, of what's left of that number, 3.something-something percent of men have severe personality disorders, where they have a lack of empathy. And it's those 3.5% of men total that are responsible for almost all rape, because they rack up multiple victims before they are eventually caught, tried, and jailed. And studies have been going on since the 70s, even off to the sides, in the recesses of psychology and psychiatry, where they've been trying to find ways to rehabilitate rapists. And what they've actually found out was, across the board, there have been multiple studies done of perpetual rapists, serial rapists. What they found out was that between 60 and 80%, depending on which study you read and how many they actually interviewed, the more they interviewed, the higher the percent raised. Not lower, it raised the more rapists they interviewed. They found out that between 60 and 80% of serial rapists were they themselves raped by a woman as a child. The psychological construct for this behavior is called reenactment of victimization, where they literally reenact the victimization they suffered in order to disown that experience from themselves. It normalizes the experience. They don't consider it rape, and so they don't consider what they've done to be rape when they do it to a woman. They have severe personality disorders and severe trauma. Reenactment of victimization. As I said, it's been studied at least since the 70s, and there are studies going back earlier than that, and they've found this to be a prevalent problem amongst serial rapists. And keep in mind, these are the people who are responsible for over 90% of rape, because 95% of men will never rape.
Now, I want to point one thing out. It is so against the tendency of men to rape that the majority of boys who are victimized by women still grow up to not be sexual predators. It's mm-hmm. still just a small percentage. It is simply that of those who do grow up to be sexual predators, they're far more likely to come from the group of boys that were victimized than to not. And that's an important distinction, because we don't want to perpetuate the myth of the vampire effect that being abused makes someone an abuser. There's right. Most people do not have that response. But it does happen, and it isn't something that absolves the original abuser or necessarily means that the person who responds that way is inherently evil. It's simply that they don't cope. Right. Other people cope and they don't. Or other people cope differently than they do.
Right. It would probably be helped if they received the help that they needed as children.
Yeah. That is one
thing. On that, according to a 2004 United States Department of Education mass study of university students, mass study, they interviewed men and women. 57% of students who reported that they'd been sexually abused as a child, 57% said that they had a male abuser. 42% reported a female offender.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a mass study done in 2004 by the Department of Education, meaning it was done in universities across the United States. 57% of students reported a male abuser, 42% reported a female abuser. And that's studying both men and women. So it's absolutely true that not everyone who is abused grows up to be an abuser. It simply is also true that of serial rapists, most of them, the vast majority of them, were raped by a woman.
Yeah, which basically what that says is that it is a factor, but not the only factor.
Correct.
So, but, you know, this also kind of goes right back to that whole bait and switch thing.
Mm, it does.
We have all of this information on this type of abuse. We have the information that shows that it is a minuscule minority among men that does this. And it's probably similar with women. It's probably a similar percentage among women. But feminists, when they quote statistics, they don't quote when they're trying to promote programs that they want to say, well, most men don't know any better, and most men need to be taught this. They don't quote that percentage because it doesn't support their narrative. Instead, they quote their false statistics on victims. And, I mean, the statistic that they've been quoting, the 1 in 4, it's not like it was debunked yesterday and they've been quoting it for, you know, 30 years and didn't know all this time. In 1993, I think it was, 1993 or 1994, the Toledo Blade in Ohio had an article called The Making of an Epidemic, in which they discussed Mary Koss's first study. And this is something that most people don't realize. Koss was a professor at Kent State University. That's the Four Dead in Ohio University. But Koss was a professor there, and a male colleague proposed the subject for do college men view women with large breasts as likely rape victims? And he had a idea for the study, and she rejected it. But decided to go ahead and study rape among students, and she came up with this survey for Kent State students, and came back with answers that 1 in 8 women had been raped. And it didn't get a lot of media attention, but Gloria Steinem from Ms. Magazine, the founder of Ms. Magazine, noticed it. And she called her and took her to lunch and talked to her about sponsoring a national campus rape survey with the goal being to get higher rape statistics. And in this article, The Making of an Epidemic, which if you Google search Toledo Blade, The Making of an Epidemic, there's I think it's PDF files of this online. But other researchers are interviewed, and there's quotes from them talking about pressure to show that rape is more prevalent than previously thought. And they go through and look at different different studies that had been done and different places to gather statistics. And for instance, let's see if I've got my – I wrote an article on this for Gender Addict called Who Defines Rape? let's see, and here it is. Duke University had different results. Survey of 1,000 women found only 1 in 17. Other studies – in the 80s and 90s include 1 in 50 urban women, 1 in 20 pregnant low-income women. The U.S. Justice Department at the time said 1 in 820 women. And the Justice Department's numbers have been stable since then. So even with all of this increase that you get from the cost study influencing feminist studies on rape, the Justice Department's numbers have been pretty consistent. And it's pretty clear that, A, they're overstating the incidence of rape by including these gray areas where the reality is women are simply not communicating, and women are using coyness and using alcohol as padding, rather than taking accountability for our own choices and our own actions. And then at the same time, they are failing to acknowledge that when rape does happen, it is not a common male behavior, but a rare male behavior that is repeated by a small number among males. So that whole bait and switch thing, they're using inflation and bait and switch to justify these expensive campaigns, and these, they've got all kinds of stuff that's riding on this. They've got you know, at being advisors to universities on rape prevention, these rape prevention programs at these universities, rape counseling centers. Somebody has to run the rape counseling centers. Feminists have to man the, or woman, the rape counseling centers. And it's quite a lucrative business there, the business of, you know, dealing with rape statistics. So that's probably one of the biggest bait-and-switch scams that's perpetrated in the United States today outside of domestic violence.
Indeed. Well, we are now, let me see here, 10 minutes over, and it is time to end the show, ladies and gentlemen. We will be doing another one next Wednesday. It hasn't been decided yet who will be interviewed or what article will be the topic of discussion. However, stay tuned to Honey Badger Radio, and we will see you again another time. Was there any final thoughts from you, Crystal? You kind of got stepped over quite a bit on this one.
I swear, I had the freaking mute button. Oh, no, no, I don't feel stepped over. It was great to listen to you guys talking on all the points. And, yeah, I mean, it's pretty much a lot of, you know, I mean, of course, I agree with what you guys have to say because a lot of it is where I feel with all of this, too. And it's just outrageous to still see it, you know, being supported by people, like, blindly so, just because it's what they know. So hopefully more people will wake up.
Indeed. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, we bid you adieu. Have a nice evening. Stay safe. Be well. Bye now.